الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام.
بسم الله، الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. For those of you keeping count, we are about halfway through Ramadan, and we are listening to the recitation of Surah Hud. There's a lot of things that are mentioned in this surah, and I'm going to try to cover as much as I can in the time that we have. But bear with me if I go a little over with the time, and inshallah I'll try to present it in a way that links the main points together. So just follow me and bear with me, inshallah. Surah Hud, in its entirety, talks about a lot of the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and some of them are messengers: Nuh, Hud, Saleh, Ibrahim, Lut, and Musa. And it mentions stories of their peoples. And they all share a similar experience with their people and similar problems with their people as the predecessor did. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about their condition in the very next surah, in Surah Yusuf, saying that the messengers, they were reprieved, and they almost gave up hope that they were going to be denied by their people. And then at that point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent his help. And at that point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rescued and guided whom he wished to guide. So in a sense, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in the verse that the prophets of Allah, they reached a stage of despair because they had suffered successive attacks and insults and denials and conspiracies at the hands of their people. But all of this was destined to happen because the sunnah and the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not change. It just goes to show that the prophets were to have patience and perseverance, and they were to encourage their people to do the same and have taqwa in Allah until Allah brings them relief. Surah Hud also was revealed after Surah Yunus and Surah Al-Isra, according to some of the scholars. And the period in which the surah is revealed is one of the saddest periods in the mission of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because it was revealed after the death of his beloved wife Khadija radiallahu anha, who was his confidant, his supporter. Also in this time, we witnessed the passing away of his beloved uncle Abu Talib, who used to give him unconditional backing and who used to protect him against the Quraysh. And so this year was aptly and rightly called the year of sorrow. As a matter of fact, this revelation of Surah Hud came at a period because it was meant to be a consolation and a source of strength for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his followers. So it is a consolation for them, for their sorrow, their distress, and their loneliness that they would feel in their society in which everybody is rejecting them and everybody is persecuting them. And so with this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions stories and parables to serve as a consolation and a lesson and to support them in their da'wah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions towards the end of Surah Hud in ayah number 120, "And each story that we relate to you from the news of the messengers is that by which we make your heart firm. Is that by which we make your heart firm. And there has come to you in this," meaning in these stories, "the truth, an instruction, and a reminder for the believers." So let's go back to the beginning of Surah Hud. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Alif Lam Ra, this is a book whose verses are perfected and presented in detail from the one who is most wise and all aware. This book is telling you to worship none but Allah, and verily Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is sent to us by Allah as a warner and a bearer of glad tidings." Last time I was here on this minbar, we were talking about tawheed and how to develop our yaqeen in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Once again, we see tawheed becomes an important aspect of these surahs, of the Quran. Internalizing la ilaha illallah is really the focus, is one of the focus of the surah. Very few ayat later, 13 and 14, we find the famous ayah challenging the non-believers to produce anything like the Quran or to bring anything similar to it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to ask them, "Or do they say that he has invented it? Say to them, then bring 10 surahs like it that have been invented and call upon for assistance whomsoever you wish, if you should be truthful." And then the next ayah, ayah number 14. And if they do not respond to you, then know that the Quran was revealed with the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no deity except Him. Again, focus on Tawheed. So this book, whose verses are perfected, explains that none should be worshipped besides Allah, and that the worship and the call towards this worship is not an innovation, and it is not something that is revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam alone. It was the mission of all the messengers and all the prophets of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Peace be upon them all. And we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the story of Nuh alayhi salam, when he told his people, "O my people, worship Allah, you have no God besides Him. O my people, worship Allah, you have no other God beside Him." So we see that all of our acts of worship must be dedicated and directed to Allah alone. Whether it's salah, siyam, qiyam, slaughtering, all of these acts of worship should be done for Allah alone. Even if it is hope, fear, seeking reliance and aid, should be only done in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and should be directed only towards Him. There should be no law that should be followed except His. And then after this introduction, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the stories of the prophets in succession. The first one is the dialogue that took place between Nuh alayhi salam and his people. They said to Nuh alayhi salam that we do not see you to be anybody over us, anybody of higher status or anything extravagant. We see you as a regular human being. And we don't see anybody follow you except that they might be from the lowest of society. They must be from the meanest of society. And that too, they are following you because they might not have high intellect. They are only following you out of sort of blind following. And we do not see you in any merit above us. In fact, we think you are liars. Subhanallah, this is the messenger of Allah. But we see that this same message is what the people told our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In a few surahs before, in Surah Al-Anfal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions what they told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, when the hypocrites and those in whose hearts was a disease, this disease of disbelief, they said to you, meaning to Muhammad and the people sallallahu alaihi wasallam, these people, meaning the Muslims, they are deceived and deluded by their religion. They are deceived and deluded by their religion. Such types of ridiculing and contemptuous statements could only come out from the mouths of people that are arrogant and have filthy minds. Because it is a scathing comment against the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his sincere companions. That's why Ibn Kathir said to this statement that the fact is that the followers of truth are the real noble people, even if they are poor. And that those who reject the truth, they are the lowest, are the meanest, they are the losers, even if they are rich. And we have many examples in the history of Islam. Heracles, the Roman emperor, when he asked Abu Sufyan about the people that follow the Prophet ﷺ, he asked, who are those people? Are they weak or are they noble people? So Abu Sufyan, he said, they are weak people. Heracles said, such are the followers of all messengers. He knew this. Because if the belief in messengers and in the belief in Allah, if it was connected to nobility and high status and in society, Islam would have not elevated Salman al-Farsi. And shirk or polytheism would not have relegated Abu Lahab, because he was the uncle of, who was the Prophet ﷺ's uncle. In another example, one time the companions, they saw Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu on a palm tree. And they looked at his like calves and his shanks, his legs, and they were very thin. So they were looking and they were laughing at it. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Are you astonished by the tenderness of his shanks? They are certainly heavier on the scale than the mountain of Uhud." Allahu Akbar. So we see those who are usually scorned by the arrogant, those who are looked down upon by the people who have a false high status in society, they will enjoy a high position in the hereafter. Why? Because of their faith they have in their Lord and their reliance upon Him in spite of their weakness and in spite of their lack of supporters. My brothers and sisters in Islam, there's another example of Lut alayhi salam mentioned in Surah Hud. When the Prophet Lut alayhi salam, he told his people, if only I had strength to overpower you, if only I could betake myself to some powerful support in order to resist you. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, may Allah bestow mercy upon Lut, he indeed had a powerful support, and that was Allah. He indeed had a powerful support, and that was Allah. So the disdained people, the people who think to themselves that, you know, we are in a bad crisis and because we're Muslim and so on and so forth, they will experience much sorrow. They will experience much anxiety. But when the truth is eventually revealed and the dwellers of hell enter their abode, then they will say about those whom they used to ridicule in this life and in this world, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah Sa'd, ayat 62 and 63, and they will say, why do we not see men whom we used to count amongst the worst? Is it because we took them in ridicule, or has our vision turned away from them? And the answer to this question is mentioned in Surah Al-A'raf, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, And the dwellers of paradise will call out to the dwellers of fire, saying, we have indeed found true what our Lord has promised us. We have indeed found true what our Lord has promised us. Have you also found true what your Lord promised you? Meaning your false deities. And then they shall say, yes. And one person, one crier from among them will proclaim, the curse of Allah is upon the wrongdoers. My brothers and sisters in Islam, in Surah Hud, we find stories of a sincere and devoted caller who loved his people dearly and whose mind was free from malice against them. He loved for them what he loved for themselves, and he recognized that it was dangerous to forsake and to disappoint them. And he would stand by his followers as if he had heard the saying of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, mentioned in Sahih Muslim, the Muslim is a brother of his fellow Muslim. He should not wrong him, nor forsake him, or surrender him to the enemy. The Muslim should not wrong his brother, nor forsake him, nor surrender him to the whims of evil thoughts that can lead him away from the right path. And this person we are talking about is none other than Nuh alayhi salam. But this concept needs to be understood extremely well by us, especially those Muslims living in the West. And we must implement it in our dealings with our brothers and sisters. We must be extremely conscious of our words and our actions, that they don't deter people away, that they don't drive people away, especially those that are Muslims, away from Islam. That is exactly what Nuh alayhi salam went through. When the people from his society, the higher people from his society, they said to him, let go of those people, meaning the poor people. Those that were actually following with sincerity. They said to him, let go of them. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this in Surah Hud, ayah 29 and 30. And O my people, I ask you of no wealth for it, meaning for this da'wah. I'm not asking you for anything in return. My reward is from none other than Allah. Again, this is the lesson. Our reward is from none other than Allah. I am not going to drive those away who have believed. Surely they are going to meet their Lord. But I see that you are a people that are ignorant. This is not a negative connotation. This is just saying that I see that you are having difficulty misunderstanding it. Isn't that what we face today? People come up to us and they slander the religion. But we think of them as ignorant in a negative connotation. So the lesson we learn is that we must be patient and we must realize that their ignorance is a lack of knowledge. And the ayah continues, O my people, who will help me against Allah if I drove them away? Regarding this ayah, Ibn Kathir, rahimullah, he said, it was as if they were asking Nuh alayhi salam to drive away the believers from him because they felt that their sitting with those believers would be undignified for them. Meaning they did not feel that it would be equal to their status. And again, we see that a similar request is made by the people of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that he should expel the weak people who are with him and give them a separate audience, give them a separate time. So when the noble of the Quraysh came and they made this request, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately revealed the ayah from Surah Al-An'am, saying that, and turn not those away who invoke their Lord morning and afternoon and seek his face. You are accountable for them in nothing and they are accountable for you in nothing. That there is no problem. Anybody that we are teaching or we are giving da'wah to, They have their own account with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we have our own account with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is up to us whether we take the patient route in da'wah or whether we haste or we try to get ourselves aggravated and the other person aggravated. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that if you turn them away, then you will become one of those who is unjust. Subhanallah. My brothers and sisters in Islam, these ayat, they teach us the importance of laying a good example and a positive effect of building society. The true Muslim does not build himself upon the ruins of his fellow Muslims. Very critical. Very, very critical. The true Muslim does not build himself upon the ruins of his fellow Muslims. He does not enjoy or prefer the life of this to the life of the hereafter. He directs people to the right path and forbids them to do evil. He does not allow ill feeling to drive him to do bad things to others. This is very common. Make one small mistake. Just yesterday we were in a masjid and some people had parked the wrong way. So the other person was trying to get out and he got so frustrated after the 8 rakah, he went out to take his car out. He got so frustrated that he came back to the masjid while the taraweeh was going, yelling at the people. Subhanallah. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, mentioned by Imam Ahmad, the Muslim of Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, whoever eats a morsel at the expense of a Muslim, whoever eats a morsel at the expense of a Muslim, Allah will feed him like thereof in hellfire. Allah will feed him the exact same thing in the hellfire. And whoever clothes himself at the expense of a Muslim, Allah will clothe him just like that in the hellfire. And whoever exposes a Muslim, Allah will expose him on the day of resurrection. How loose are we with our tongues when we are talking about our fellow brothers and sisters in Islam? How easy is it for us to slander them without sometimes even realizing that we have done this? We're mocking them. My brothers and sisters, another lesson that we learn from this surah is that all of the messengers, they call their people to the way of Allah. All of the messengers. And when their people refused to accept this message, different kinds of punishment came down to them. Among them were those who met with a violent wind with showers of stone. Among those were those who were seized by an awful cry. Amongst those were them who Allah caused the earth to swallow. And among those were them who drowned. And towards the end of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these are some of the news of the people before you, or the towns before you, that which we have related unto you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Some of them are still standing, and some of them have already reaped, meaning some of them are already gone. And in the two ayat later, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, such is the seizure of your Lord that when he seizes the people of a town or a village when they are doing wrong, verily his seizure and his punishment is severe and painful. And then again towards the end of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions a warning to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as well to the believers and to his servants against doubting the truthfulness of this message. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, so be not in doubt, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Be not in doubt as to what these people, meaning the people that are with you, the polytheists and the people that are deterring you away from Islam, be not in doubt as to what these people worship. They worship nothing but what their fathers have worshipped before them. And verily, we shall repay them in full portion. And by the translation of this payment in full portion, it's not a monetary translation. It really just means that they will face the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as He wills, because they refuse to follow the message. It is this exact worry that made the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam afraid for his ummah, afraid for the future of his ummah, so much so that the companion said that this worry caused him to have gray hair. It was this worry for his ummah, of the beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that caused him to have gray hair. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not want his followers to meet the same fate, and he said in an authentic hadith in Sahih Bukhari, all members of my ummah will enter paradise except him who refuses to follow. All members of my ummah will enter paradise except him who refuses to follow. So now you say, just like the companions did, who would refuse to follow? So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, whoever obeys me will enter paradise, and whoever disobeys me has refused to do so. Allahu Akbar. And just one last thing that I want to mention, a very beautiful quote, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he said, do not rush while reciting this surah. Do not rush while reciting this surah as you rush in your recitation of poetry, and do not hasten with it as ripened dates fall off its tree. Ponder over its marvelous meanings and let it shake your hearts. Let none of you think only of when he is going to finish this surah. So with that, I wanted to finish, and may Allah give us the ability to understand and implement and be able to practice in our daily life and apply in our daily life the stories that are mentioned in this surah and the lessons that we learn from this surah from all of the messengers and all of the prophets of Allah. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon them all. Wa akhira da'wana and alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
إنما المؤمنون الذين إذا ذكر الله وجلت قلوبهم وإذا تليت عليهم آياته زادتهم إيمانا وعلى ربهم يتوكلون.
The knowledge continues.